to meditate with me on the topic of silence, stillness, solitude, and God's leading. Silence, stillness, solitude, and God's leading. Or, for those of you who like subtopics, resting and not worrying. Resting and not worrying. I'd like to invite you to look with me to the book of Psalms, the 46th chapter, beginning in verse 1. The book of Psalms, 46th chapter, beginning in verse 1. And it reads as follows. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I want to just invite you to focus with me on those couple of verses, those couple of last verses, verses 10 and 11. Be still and know that I am God. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. As you know, so often we get caught up in words and meanings, and so I figured we should start with the sense of where I'm going with these words. And I think it's pretty straightforward. When we talk about silence, we mean no noise. When we talk about stillness, we mean no motion. And when we talk about solitude, the one that perhaps is a little more challenging, we're talking about no people. We're talking about open and empty space, free from any competing interests and loyalties, to be found by God. Silence, stillness, solitude, and God's name. There is no secret to any of us in this room about the level of confusion in which we live our lives. We live our lives in utter and sheer confusion. Even the most peaceful among us live in a space of constantly, yes, I said constantly, trying to fight sheer confusion. All we need to do is turn on the news. All we need to do in some instances is walk out the door. And for some of us, we think all we need to do is go to work. And there is confusion. In the media, it's church burnings, it's murders in churches of innocent people, and murders of people who are innocent all over the place. It's illness, it's calamity, it's confusion, it's the stress of work, it's the stress of life, it's the stress of moving from point A to point B. Oh, and then Boston from reflection of what is going on in our minds, in our hearts, in our bodies, and even in our spirits. We live in a state of confusion. But what do we do about it? I don't know about you, but sometimes we're so busy running, we're flush, we have headaches. Our pressures are up beyond what they should be. We're not kind. We're not patient. We're not long-suffering. The fruits of the Spirit are being tossed out the window with the rest of the trash we're dealing with. Do you know what I'm talking about? This is precisely what the psalmist had in mind. Except he was writing from the perspective of confusion that was being resolved. It is believed that this particular psalm was likely written around the time when King David, in accordance with 2 Samuel, was at war with neighboring nations. And then, not only did he win, but God gave him rest. I don't know about you, but we need rest. I need rest. Someone said, how was your vacation? I said, I got some rest. Got some downtime. Just a bit. People expect you to do something slightly different. Why don't we take advantage of that opportunity? You see, solitude is that time with God that is completed with silence. It's intimacy time. It's time, personal time with Jesus. And so as we began with music, for some of us, music helps bring about that. For some of us, it's the ocean crashing up against the rocks. For some of us, it's early morning when the dew is still on the roses. For some of us, it's that quiet closet in our homes when no one knows we are. For some of us, it's in the middle of a crowd where we can hear nothing but our own breathing. Well, yes, this is definitely just nice of you to say, but really, how do we get to silence? How do we get to stillness? How do we get to solitude? Well, I want you to know that Jesus knew this question would come. So the Bible is filled with example after example after example of how we get to it. And so Jesus was our primary example. Because Jesus would get up, not late at night, but very early in the morning, while it was still dark, and he would leave and go to a solitary place to pray. That's what Mark tells us. And then Luke tells us he would go find a lonely place. And 1 Kings tells us that Elijah went to a cave and spent the night, and that the word of the Lord came to him in a still, small voice. Still, Jesus showed that solitude can actually be achieved in community. So Jesus went in community with the disciples in private to pray. See, we find rest. We can find strength and repentance, salvation and quietness and trust. That's what the prophet Isaiah reminded us. So sometimes we just have to stop, get quiet. As Jesus showed us in that example, where he went into the back of the boat in the midst of a storm, and their fear, the fear of the disciples, caused him to get up and go and say to the storm, "Peace, be still." Sometimes you just gotta say to everything around you, "Peace, be still. I'm going away. get up a little earlier tomorrow morning so I can have some peace. I'm going to go out into my garden where the grass is growing. I'm going to the park so I can find some peace. I'm going to walk my dog so I can find some peace. I'm going to go sit on a bench and watch the water so I can be still by myself and listen. Oh, I know. I know. It's a little scary to be alone with your thoughts. It's a little scary sometimes to find out what might come your way as you're reflecting what God has for you. And if it frightens you, say, Lord, bless me. If it scares you, say, Lord, cover me. If it's something you've never thought of, write it down and say, Lord, help me to understand. But don't forsake the fellowship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Not only corporate fellowship as we do here every Sunday, but your personal fellowship. Oh, I know. I know. How can I hook up with the Lord, right? Okay, that's cute stuff, but that's real cute, but tell me the truth. How do I really have a relationship with God? Well, let's think about it for a minute. We've all been to an event. We've all been to a gathering of people. We've all connected on the internet, social media, email. We've connected with someone. We've been in group chats. We've been in group meetings. We've been in group homes. We've been in dorms. We've been in all kinds of crowds where we meet people. And what happens? Think about the last time you went to get close to someone. Oh, that house that we don't get into that. Yeah, I'm there. Think about the last time you wanted to get to know someone. How did you do that? You were at a party, say. You were at a gathering, say. You were at a family reunion. And there's music, and there's food, and there's noise, and there's engagement, and there's laughter.
So I went and I sat down.
leery that I was wasting my time, concerned that I might not get my work done. I eventually breathed my way through and was able to get quiet, only to realize that long before I ever arrived at college, God knew that I would arrive at that moment. Long before I ever finished high school, God knew that I would have that confusion. Long before I ever thought about feeling that level of stress, God knew that I would feel it. And so years before, God saw to it that there was a little account that I had forgotten I had. Huh? That's God. Because I called somebody who called somebody and got my hands on that money. Yes, call somebody for my child here. Is what you did before you had an ATM card that was a computer that allows you to get directly to your door. You made phone calls and you have bankers and people you talk to. We don't talk to people as much these days. But it was in that stillness and it was in that silence that I was able to hear the voice of God. You see, the blessing of this song is that not every message that God has for you is coming in a burning bush like it came to Moses. Not every message that God has for you has to hit you upside the head. Not every message and every blessing is going to come in the form of this loud and boisterous experience. See, Jesus is reminding us that in stillness, no motion. In silence, no sound. And in solitude, no people. That is where we can find God. That is where we can find our solutions. That is where we can find peace. That is where we can find rest. And that is where we can put worry behind us. And God said so. So my message to you today is be still. Be still. Be still. Because God is God. God is our fortress. God will deliver us. In Christ, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. In Christ, all things will be made new. In Christ, we are new creatures. In Christ, whatever that calamity and confusion is that you may face, has a solution that's just beyond the stillness, that's just beyond the solitude, that's just beyond the silence. God will lead you to what you need. For he said, I will never, ever leave you nor forsake you. As that song reminds us, he did bring you this far to leave you. See, oh, we know we've come this far by faith. And if you haven't been leaning, start leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. For he has never failed you yet. Oh, I know, I met a woman on Thursday. I found her in the bathroom in tears. And she said, this was a waste of my time. I should never have come. And I said, why was a waste of your time? She said, I should never have come here because nothing's going to be done. And I know it's just going to be a failure. And I'm going to lose my home. I'm going to be all by myself. I said, honey, no. That's not going to be the case. I said, I want you to come right back in here to this office with me. Have you eaten? She said, no. I said, I have some lunch, and I'm going to give you some water. And I want you to just be still. And I want you to know that she came back, and she was still. And I gave her a couple of hours just to be still, and I went back to see her, and I said, do you believe in her higher power? And she said she did. So we prayed, and I want you to know that in her silence, in her solitude, and in the stillness that she had not achieved that entire day, for she had been racing around, she had been running around, she had been calling everybody she could come up with, she had been to every office that she thought of, and she was yet planning to run. But before she left, by the grace of God, I was able to say to her, your hearing will be expedited. Not only will your hearing be answered, but we've already spoken to your lawyer. Look at what God will do when we just get still. She said, well, how does my attorney know I'm here? I said, because you already are working with the person who knows how they are. You are working with the best of the best. Oh, honey, it's already been worked out. If we just be still and know that God is God and that there is nothing and no one who could come against you when you have the power of the living God on your side. No matter what calamity we see in the world, no matter what war we see in the world, no matter what you believe is coming at you, no matter what we believe is coming at the church, no matter what we believe is coming at God, God has the last word. So in stillness, in silence, and in solitude, I encourage you to follow God's leading and to rest